Hello, my name is Geraldine Tuck, and I'm the author of 4 books in the Mystery Marauders series. What I like to do the most, besides writing, is daydream. Everyone daydreams. We've been daydreaming since the caveman times. Those who built the pyramid daydreamed. Your parents, your grandparents, people who sit beside you. We all daydream. It is the stuff of where stories come from. Now you might ask, why do I like mysteries? And why do I like history? And I think it's because they go together like a hand in glove. When you're writing, you have to come up with an idea. So where do ideas come from? Well, if you're like me and you like history, some of your work is done for you. I particularly like going back to the 1930s. In book 1, Midnight Marauders, my main characters, Dan and Becky, who are 11, befriend rum runners. There's the history. The mystery is, where did those rum runners stash the hooch? What happened if they got caught? And so I attach on a mystery to a history. In book 2, Moonlight Marauders, did you know that Nova Scotia has had 3 gold rushes? That's the history part. The mystery is, what if somebody lost a gold nugget and there was a race to find it? Is it going to be the Marauders or will it be you? Now for book 3, the mystery was a no-brainer. Nova Scotia's most famous mystery, of course, the mystery of Oak Island. But other things were happening around that time when the boys discovered an indent on an island. And was there a pirate's treasure hidden there? The War of 1812 also had its own history and mystery. And so sometimes I would research several events in our history and meld them together. My last book, book 4, I researched the Halifax explosion and I thought, what happened to all of the people's belongings that were lost? Maybe I could weave a mystery around something that was lost. I'd like to touch upon 3 topics. Where do ideas come from? Don't worry about making mistakes, and how to add detail without making your sentence a mile long. To be a writer, you need 2 things. You must be observant, and you must be curious. Let's take people, for example. We know that people look different, they dress different, but they also move different. They have little odd habits. Do they have a crooked smile? Do they stutter? Do they drag one foot? People watching, a favorite pastime of all writers. You should try it. One day, I found this ornament in a box that belonged to my aunt. I was curious about it. How old is it? Who made it? Why did she buy it? Did she love it? Did she ever lose it? I thought to myself, I could use this in a story. It could be a thread in this story while my main characters, maybe they're on a quest to find it. Maybe it was lost. Maybe it was lost during the Halifax explosion. And my main characters set out to find it. And when they do, trouble follows. One day I was in an antique shop. I saw this lovely little brownie camera. The film is inside, you take a picture, click, turn, take a picture, click, turn. This camera could take 10 pictures. It was the top of the line of its kind. Perhaps somebody in my story loved taking photographs. Put that in too. My grandfather, George, was in the army during World War I, the Halifax explosion. took place towards the end of the war in 1917. I wonder what he thought about the explosion. Did he know anybody that was hurt? Did he lose anybody? Was he actually in Europe when this happened, or was he in Halifax? I can't ask him, but I still do have some relatives that I could ask, and I could put that in my story too. And so to write my books, I had to be observant. I had to look around. I had to find objects. I had to be curious about the objects I found, some of the objects I used and some I didn't. It doesn't matter. The second thing I mentioned was, don't worry about making mistakes. We all make mistakes. I'm going to tell you a little story, something that happened to me when I was in grade 3 or 4. Our teacher said to us, write a story. And I did. Then she called me up to her desk and she said, it's a wonderful story, very creative, but it is full of mistakes. As it turned out, I could not hear the sounds of any of the vowels. They all sounded the same to me. Also, some letters jumped around. They would trade places. I did not know at the time that I was dyslexic. Turns out a lot of people have trouble with their letters and their sounds, so I'm not alone there. What I did for many years is I did continue to write stories, lots and lots of stories, but I would hide them away. I tucked them under my bed. I never shared them. When I was older and more confident, I found ways to fix my mistakes. I learned to ask for help. I learned to use a dictionary. And I even now, I just shout out to Hey Google for spelling. Don't be afraid to make mistakes. There are people you can ask for help that will make you feel better. And if you have a story, it is worth sharing. Sometimes you might ask, how can I make my story better once I have corrected the spelling? I might want to have a better sentence. Now that's a whole different story in itself. So writers have tricks. One of the tricks that they like to use that I will share with you is, again, it goes with your curiosity. You must ask questions. For example, if you wrote the sentence, the sun was hot, what you could do instead is just ask yourself, well, how hot? How hot was that sun? The sun was so hot, I could fry an egg on the sidewalk. Wow. That's a hot sun. Ask yourself how. I was cold. How cold? I was so cold, icicles hung from my nose. What you want to do is add detail so that the reader sees what you see inside your head, inside their head. They feel what you feel, they smell, they taste. You add the detail, but it doesn't mean a really long sentence. I was scared. I think you've caught on now. You should be saying, how scared? How does your body change when you're scared? I was so scared, my legs felt like spaghetti. Okay. Or you could say, I was so scared, my legs were frozen to the spot. The cruise boat was big. The cruise boat loomed as high as a mountain. So you are comparing one thing to another. What does it remind you of? I was hungry. What happens to your body when you're hungry? My stomach growled loud enough to scare a lion. Boy, you must have been really hungry. If a house is old, how would you know it was old? The house stood vacant for 100 years. Your reader knows that if it was vacant, it was probably neglected and in badly need of a paint job. The lake was still. How still? The lake looked like a polished mirror, but here's another trick. Take away the look, or as, which is a simile, and you could rewrite this even simpler. Not the lake looked like a polished mirror, but the lake was a polished mirror. Okay? Short, descriptive detail. I would like to read for you a short passage from my book one as an example of how I tried to be observant with characters and setting. My main character, Dan, and his friend Corker, and Corker's dog, have been kidnapped and are on a boat heading out to sea. Soon the Martha Ray was skipping her way across the gray Atlantic. Tom and Hugh stood at the helm, protected from the spray by the glass windows of the wheelhouse. They were in a carefree mood, joking and jostling each other as if on a family outing. Meanwhile, Corker looked as if a battle had been lost before the fight had begun. The big black dog sensed trouble. Stacy whimpered softly while her master absentmindedly scratched behind her ear. Ocean swells spewed freezing spray across the bow. Dan had never been so cold. His sweater provided little protection from the icy blast of a northwest wind. The miserable ride was worse than any punishment he could ever imagine. Corker spoke only once. In a low tone, he whispered, "I ignored the law to deal with the devils that ran the rum. Always knew there'd be a price to pay. Sorry, lad. Sorry that you got mixed up in me mess." With eyes wide and teeth clenched, he turned to face Dan. "Remember what I tell you. If you get out of this one alive, keep your bones honest, or you'll answer to me, spirit." For the rest of the long ride, Dan did not know if his teeth rattled from the cold or from Corker's threatening advice. Tom steered across the Mahone Bay waters. Finally, he nosed Martha Ray into the protected inlet of a densely wooded island. "Hugh, throw out the anchor. Hey, kid, start pumping. We got ourselves a little weight." Dan worked the handle on the starboard side, flushing the bilge. The stench of stagnant salt water was the least of Dan's worries. His arms ached with the strain of the continuous motion, but he dared not stop till the pump sucked dry. Tom, meanwhile, raided the cabin. Proudly, he plunked 2 pint bottles and 4 tins of peaches on top of the engine box. Hugh added a deck of cards and a pack of black cat cigarettes. Soon, the two men were cursing their way through a not-so-friendly game of poker. They bet on their cards with peach halves that they plopped into each other's tins with sharp fish knives. Dan sat on the deck next to the dog. He'd lost count of the number of hands dealt and the peaches smacking back and forth. Closing his eyes to shut out the scowling faces, he said a little prayer. "Please, Becky, get my dad to the right island." He knew there were about 365, one for every day of the year. There was no time for guesswork. His life depended on it. I would also like to share with you a paragraph from one of my favorite writers, Vivian Van Valde, from her book, Hidden Magic. As I'm reading this, just think about how many times she uses her sense of smell, of sight, of touch. She describes a cave. "The cave was filled with a smell of rotting leaves, never swept out from autumn's long past, and with the sound of water dripping down slimy walls to form murky puddles on the rough floor. For anyone who dared to peek inside, there was an assortment of cobweb-covered jars and boxes containing secret things. A foul-smelling cauldron that bubbled thickly day and night throughout the years, and several species of mushrooms growing in the darkest corners. There was also a hand-embroidered picture that bore the message, 'Home, sweet home.'" In closing, I would like to say If you enjoy writing mysteries, then read a lot of good mysteries. To write your own, if you get stuck, don't forget, you can turn to history to get ideas. Or you could pick up an item and you can wonder, if he could talk, what would he tell you? Either way, enjoy. Enjoy reading, enjoy writing, and just daydream. Keep daydreaming. Thank you.